I'm
sure
mean,
we are live.
okay. Yo la, good evening everyone. This is Ruchira and I welcome you all for our today's conversation. Hope you all are doing well and amazing. Extremely sorry for delay. There were some technical glitches. So as all you all know that this year we are celebrating the birth century of late R.K. Lakshman, and we are planning number of programs and events on the occasion. So to celebrate him, as we have started this series called Conversing with the Common Man, and in this series we will be bringing many guest speakers for you. They will talk about their expert areas and also about their association with R.K. Lakshman. I'm sure this will be a great learning experience for all of us. In our last episode, we had Ravish Kumarji with us, and it was a great learning experience. Listening to him was fun and inspiration at the same time. If you haven't watched it yet, then please watch it after this session gets over. So listening to experts and their perceptions about R.K. Lakshman is always a motivating experience. But today we have brought something interesting for you all. So you can see today on the eve of this his birthday evening, we are going to have an interesting conversation with his family members. Let's understand him as a person and beyond his cartoons. So without wasting much of the time, let's begin. So today we have Srinivas Lakshman, his son, Usha Lakshman, his daughter-in-law, Rimanika Lakshman, his granddaughter, and Sriniti, his grandniece. So welcome everyone.
Thank you, Ruchira.
Welcome, Ruchira. Good job.
So as we all are meeting on this eve of his birthday, my very first question to all of you is, how did he celebrate your birthday? I mean, you know, how did he keep the track of your birthday, your phases of your growth? And I would like to start with Usha aunty. Would you like to share with us how he used to celebrate his beloved wife's birthday and then, of course, yours birthday, your birthday?
Yeah. Thanks, Ruchira. And hi to all of you. It's a very important day for all of us, you know, the family coming together and remembering both mom and dad in celebration of our dearest dad's, the start of the 100th birth anniversary. Yes, he used to be very excited, and the demand that came from mom was, all that I need from you is a birthday greeting card. And Lord Ganesha used to be her favorite. And every year he would create something new and different type of Ganesha, you know, sketch, which he would give her as a greeting card. And that was something which she cherished all her life and which was very, very close to her. But of course, while he used to sit at home and sketch these Ganeshas, she never had a chance to see it till it was given to her on her birthday. So that's the way, you know, this was done. And she has a huge collection that was done by her husband.
What about you?
Yeah, and when it comes to birthday of the family, he used to be like a kid. From the very previous day, he would say, you know, he would go around looking at the birthday person and saying, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. Like how any kid would get excited about their birthday. And that's the child in him we always used to cherish. And even now, even to this day, we remember that. And that's the way it used to be. And always set his time aside for the family's birthday celebration, where, you know, and coming together to cut the cake and whatever that was, he was always there, set aside that time to be part of the family and the celebration of the particular family member's birthday.
So do you remember any particular gift?
I remember once he did a very beautiful Ganesha greeting card for me saying, happy birthday, Usha. So that is something, of course, I've cherished. Well, of course, as far as his son was concerned or his granddaughter was concerned, there were some amazing things that he has done. So I think it will be interesting to hear it from both of them,
yes.
You know, with the greeting cards that he has done,
yeah,
for them.
Yes.
I guess you have to pass it on.
Yeah.
To,
so let's hear from his son. Chini, would you like to share your experience, your memories?
Of what? Birthday?
Yeah.
Oh, birthday.
Yeah.
Dad, you see, I'm a space geek and a space addict. And the reason I blame him is my dad. The reason is, 8 years before Neil Armstrong set foot on the surface of the moon, he did a card of me cycling on the surface of the moon. And that card is a very, very important card for me. I've got it displayed in the dining room. Ruchira's got a copy in her mobile phone. And there it is. And this card is very important for me. Now, what is significant about this card is when the then project director of Chandrayaan 1, which was launched on October 22nd, 2008, Dr. Anandurai came home before the launch. He looked at this card and said, "You are the first man who stood on the moon, not Armstrong," in a very humorous way. That's what I really remember about this card. And that card has really influenced my career towards the stars. Thanks, Dad. You're great.
So, Farry, do you have any more sketches by him?
Can you tell us about this?
Who, Farry or me?
You.
The one on the left is when I did my SSC exam. The one on the right, the middle one, is when we were in the China border. Dad and I went to the China border, September 26th, the year of, I forget, 1970s or something, Nautula. That figure shows that. And the one on the right was when I joined the Times of India. I think that is the card. Yeah, that's it.
So, what is the idea behind it?
Yeah.
Behind what?
All three.
Monkey, one on the left. What does it say? Tikku? Can you just read? I can't see
it from here. It is happy birthday to you, Tikri.
Tikri. Okay, SSC exam. Number two, Maharashtra board, SSC board. Remo and I, Pune board. Okay. Number two, China border, Nautula. When we went, because mom was not allowed on top, the China border trip. That was pretty good.
I think you can even talk to them about, your fascination for mountains, Mount Everest.
And I had that fascination.
And how you met Neil Tenzing.
Tenzing,
Tenzing Norgay and Edmund Hillary. Maybe you could share that.
Did I meet Edmund? Okay.
Yes, we did.
But I don't know when that fits into this. Yes. But frankly, okay, I had a fascination for Mount Everest at one time. And when Dad and I, Mom, went to Darjeeling, we did our best to go and see it on a certain night. But that day it was clouded. When I was in Kathmandu also, we tried to go to a particular point to see, get a glimpse. But again, my luck ran out. The area was clouded. But then he did a sketch of me showing, looking at Mount Everest.
But what was fascinating about these birthday cards that he did of his son was, right from he was 2 years old, is just, the cards that he did, the sketches that he did, actually showed the face of his life and the growth year after year, the passion that he had, the fascination that he had as per his age, which is really amazing because he's done some colorful
stuff. Look at the rocket on the left, flying. That is before I went to the moon, okay? That is just starting. The one on the right is the Air India. One of my birthdays, I wore a pilot's video. I had a fascination for aircraft and that moving on to space, taking off in an Air India aircraft. That's it. He did a super job. I don't know.
Basically, track your growth.
He tracked very well. Tracked my growth.
Very different.
Yeah, this one, Sri Lanka. Dad and Mom were in Sri Lanka. This was, I think, Mauritius. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, where I got drowned.
That's no. This is not Mauritius. This is Andamans.
Andamans. Okay, Andamans.
Yes, yes.
Okay, Andamans. Okay.
So he had also fascination for maps. In fact, he had a massive collection of maps of different countries, different states, and all of that. So that this was the period when this kind of card was given to him.
Let's remove one.
No, you finish with this.
Yeah. So this one, Camp 12, what is it?
When I was in NCC, remember I've done NCC training. I went to Dehu Road in Pune, and I was a night sentry. Guys, I wore a uniform like that and stood with a gun in my hand. You know that? I was a chowkidar at one time.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes, I was a chowkidar. And you're sitting next to a chowkidar. Yeah, that's it. You can't believe it. It's a tough life I've led.
Yeah.
And on a birthday, I celebrated in the camp.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, did you receive this card at the camp?
Camp, how can you give a card? Nobody is allowed. When I came, 22nd October, I was in Dehu Road. When I came here, he had kept it ready.
Okay, that's interesting.
Very interesting.
So, Parry, do you have any more cards for Srini?
No, these are all that I have.
So, Rimanika, you must be having so many memories because you are his granddaughter. So, Would you like to share your experience? We have few sketches for you, by the way.
Sorry?
We have few sketches for you.
I remember all the birthday cards that my grandfather gave me. And it used to be really nice to see because he has observed my entire year and then came to know my interests and then made a card out of that, which is something that is very special and dear to my heart. And in the previous ones, my dad's, the one with the newspaper, the greeting card, he's 24 years old in that. And now I'm 24 and I just miss my grandfather's card so much. It just like when I saw my dad's card of 24, I was like, if he was here, I wonder what he would do for me right now.
He would have done Oxford.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I remember like we used to watch the TV together all the time, and he used to watch things like Heidi and like
Tom and Jerry.
Mickey Mouse and things like that. And he used to tell me about Walt Disney and how the caricatures are made for the cartoons and everything. And TV was like one bonding session that we used to have every evening. So, I think that's the first card. Yeah?
Yeah.
The common man coming out of the TV.
Yeah.
Yes.
And your fascination for... Yeah. Watching
TV. Yeah, I just loved watching TV and then having my grandfather there to support me and support me in the sense, teach me how the cartoons are made and educate me about what happens behind the scenes as well. It's just something that kids don't get and they don't know about it at all till they are adults. Whereas I knew about it from the time I've been watching it.
Yes.
Sorry, do you have any more sketches?
Oh, yeah, many more.
Yeah, before I go to the next one.
Yeah.
Can I know why pizza is mentioned there in this one?
I have no idea. I used to eat only home food when I was a kid, and like even like junk food would be made at home. So even if there was a pizza, it would be like my grandmother would make the pizza on a Sunday night. So I have no idea why a pizza is there. Although pizza is my favorite food, so maybe he knew me better than I remember.
Yeah, so so as far as I know...
I think inspired by pizza, by the way.
Yeah, I can vouch for the fact that Rimanika loves pizza. Because when me and Rimanika used to stay in Oxford, that is the only food that we used to order.
Because and it's the easiest thing to order. It's like it takes 10 minutes to come to you. And like... It's just easier than waiting for anything else to
be delivered. I think your grandfather must have predicted that.
Yeah.
Correct. The sixth sense that he always
has. Maybe I like pizza because of the card. You never know.
Yeah, maybe. So these are a few more.
So there's a story behind this. I used to wear a black skirt with like neon flowers on it. And it used to be my favorite thing to wear. I would probably send it for a wash, and as soon as it came back for a wash, I'd wear it again and then send it for a wash. That's how much I used to wear that. And then after it became like a little worn and things like that, I cut out the flowers from the skirt and I made a card of my own about it. And my grandfather kept that in mind and he made these greeting cards.
That's so sweet.
That's the way he has observed so much.
Yeah.
Yeah,
taste and interest.
And we have a special one here. This one is
We had a birthday theme around penguins because I loved penguins. I just loved the, like, they look like little things wearing tuxedos. So I just love penguins. And we had a whole birthday theme around people painting their own pebbles into penguins. And I think that's when this card is, or the birthday has been inspired by this card.
It's like every birthday of hers, it used to be a theme party, and you know, so you could, some of them actually features in his birthday cards.
So there's a question from the audience.
Yeah,
who's asking you, how do you feel looking at the drawings now?
I remember them like it was yesterday that he gave them to me, but it feels so nice to actually see them. I was literally wondering where all these cartoons are because my mom has kept them so preciously that she doesn't even allow me to see it. So
now you can see them.
Yeah, I've already told Fairy to send this to me after the video is over.
Yeah, right.
So, another question, which is again from me, which is addressed to everyone here, all of you. So, what is the fondest memory that you have of Lakshman sir? See, fondest memory in the sense, it doesn't really have to be about, you know, his drawings and coming in the newspaper, people covering articles about him, no. Fondest memory of him at home.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start with the youngest. Yeah, let's go to the end. I think we'll start with Rupalika.
Yes.
Youngest is Sridhati.
Youngest is Sridhati. Let's start with Sridhati.
Yeah, let's start with Sridhati.
Given a chance.
I think the last time I saw him was in my Bangalore apartment when he came to visit my parents and us. And he was in his wheelchair because he was kind of sick at that time. So he came, but still, like, his hands were all shaking, but still he came, drew portraits of me and my brother and everything. He captured such distinctive characteristics of my ears, like one big and one short. So he actually captured that in his caricatures, and then it's still there in my house somewhere. I have to find it. But yeah, that's like one of the, I think the last memories I have had of him. And like, and most of it is like of his cartoons I've been seeing constantly for the past 1.5 years, like while watermarking it, is like just the way he's influenced me is what is amazing and what my memory is of him.
Oh, actually here I'd like to come in. Srinidhi has been one person in the family who has seen the whole gamut of the volumes of the cartoons that Dad has done, which we are now in the process of classifying and categorizing them. And I think she's one person who has seen it all. And there's quite a bit of it that she has taken in. And the reactions as a young, you know, coming from a younger generation is really amazing. And I've had the experience with her to see it live, you know, the live reaction of a younger generation to see Dad's cartoons. And I'm sure she will add, you know, yeah, something more to say about that in the later questions,
yes,
right?
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
So let's next, Rumalika. What is the fondest memory that you have of Lakshman sir?
Fondest memory would be like any memory that I spent with my grandparents, because and it's much of it is in the early life, because after he got sick, we of course spoke and everything, but it was more just me telling him about my day and him just listening intently about everything that is going on in my life. But the fondest of those memories, I would say, is him driving me to school every day when I was, I think, 3 years old or 4 years old, something like that. He used to, like, I used to sit in the front seat of the car, and anytime he needed to honk the horn, he used to let me do it because that used to be my favorite thing throughout. And
classic grandfather type.
Sorry?
The classic grandfather type. Every grandfather.
Yeah, the classic grandfather. And it used to be literally a 10-minute drive. And sometimes if there was no honking needed for the first 7 minutes, he would allow me to honk for the next 3 continuously till I reached the school, which is something that everybody used to get irritated by, because this was like in like close to 2000, so 20 years ago. So okay, like nobody used to have that many cars in Mumbai streets and things like that. So neighbors used to like yell every day at 9 o'clock. We used to pass by the same road honking away, like blissfully chatting and honking away in the car.
Wow, that's amazing. And talking about the car of Lakshman sir, I've heard, maybe I might be wrong, I've heard that he used to have a black Ambassador. Am I right, ma'am?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I've heard that that is the only car that he ever considered to be a car. Is that right?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Why is that? Why is the black ambassador a featured car in his life? Do you have any idea?
He used to say that that is the only car that you should drive because it has like the muscle and it is a respectful car and people like they notice it when you drive it. It's not something that you can like, first of all, it's very safe. I mean, in those days, comparatively, it was very safe. It was like relatively large for our entire family and things like that. But also you noticed an ambassador when you, when it passed you on the road. Not everybody had an ambassador. It was like something that only government, I think, had it at that time. And it used to be mostly white ambassadors, but his fascination with black is very evident in his caricatures. So the same thing he took towards his car.
Amazing.
Yeah, in fact, to add one more thing to it, you know, every time this was a car provided by Times of India for him. And every time when they were giving him, you know, a new set of, I think every 3 years, every 5 years, they used to change his car. And of course, the demand was always from him, an ambassador car. So Times of India actually had to be, and because it was black, Times of India had to, you know, order 3 black ambassadors in order to get the black color car for him. So that's the kind of fascination he had and, you know, towards an ambassador car, which he drove. He never had a driver. He drove himself, whether it was within the city or even going all the way to Pune or even driving all the way up to Mysore, you know, to meet his family. So, and all through he used the same car. And he was driving till he got his first stroke. He never kept a driver.
And after that, he gave me driving advice, saying that whenever you park your car, you should always reverse and park it so that it is easy to get out in an emergency. And that has like stuck with me so like well that I cannot park my car in any other way. It has to be parked like easy to escape if you have to in an emergency.
And your car is now parked in the same place where you used to park his.
Yeah.
Your fond memory about
it. Oh, I have many memories, but two things, you know, always remain, you know, within me, in me. He, I don't know, right from day one, there is something that he noticed with me that I have that artist instinct in me. And he used to be literally after me. And he was a person who never believed in teaching art, and he thought that something has to come from within and practice from within, and that's the way you can take it forward. But I don't know for what reason, but he was after me and he said, I want you to sketch one day. I wanted you to sketch. And every time he would say that, I would just run away from him, you know, because the fear, I can't even draw a line straight. I'm zero as far as drawing and sketching is concerned. And so I used to just run away from him. But finally, one day, you know, came where I had no way of escaping this. He gave me a big chart paper and I said, today you are going to draw something. I don't care, but you have to draw. So I had to build up courage within me and I took a pencil. And in a huge chart paper, mind you, I landed up drawing a small little elephant, a pathetic, poor little elephant in one of the corners. As I was sketching, he said, I think for the first time, my judgment has been wrong. So just get lost, get away from my sight. I know you cannot draw for nuts. So that's the one thing I'll always keep very close to my heart of he, you know, having this kind of feeling for me. And this was pretty early in time. This was soon after my marriage. But later on, which was say about in 2010, roughly, I'm just quoting a year, when I happened to go shopping somewhere in one of those crowded areas. And he had this habit of always tracking his family as to where they were, you know, with his mobile. He would keep on calling to check where we are we safe? The concern that he had for the family to know where they are, you know, are they coming back home safely, kind of stuff. So he called me and he said, where are you? I said, I'm just crossing the road to catch a taxi to come back home. He said, oh, be careful. Don't talk while you're crossing. Don't talk on the phone while you're crossing. Don't talk on the phone while you're walking. Never use a mobile phone when you are in action. So and then he said, by the way, the reason why I'm telling you this emphatically is because I have done a cartoon related to this, which is appearing tomorrow. And every cartoon that he has done, he never used to share with the family, and we did not have the guts or the right to ask him what's appearing tomorrow. What we saw the next day in the newspaper is what he did the previous day. But I had this opportunity to hear from him the cartoon that's appearing tomorrow, thanks to the mobile phone that I was using while crossing the road. So these are my very, very close fond memories, besides many, many more.
What about you, Sri?
Okay, folks, I got a chance. Good. I'll just go back to June 1985. It was in London. I was in London for the India Cup. I can mention that.
Yeah.
Okay. Dad and I had gone to Paris together. But he had gone for the Festival of India show, and I had gone for the Airbus Industry Paris Air Show. Then from there, I flew to London, and I was staying at the India Club at Strand for a number of days, where Dad had stayed, and my uncle R.K. Narayan had stayed there. So he said, stay there. It is not the most comfortable place, but a very homely place. I liked that place very much. And every morning, I used to get out, go walking around London and this and that. And morning around 9 o'clock, the door used to knock. The hotel guy used to come, can I take the refuse, sir, this, that, and all. One day, the knock came, same time, and I said, can you please wait? Voice said, yes, you can, I'll wait. Then I said, in 2 minutes, he said, take your time. When I opened it, it was my dad. I was shocked. When did he land up in London? He said, are you ready? I said, give me 2 minutes. I got ready, and he said, come, I'm taking you around London, walking. Throughout London, I'm taking you walking. 5 minutes later, we lagged down. He took me to, I remember that McDonald's. I showed Rems and Usha that very McDonald's next to Charing Cross Station. He went there next to the counter for breakfast, and he started, what did he? The lady said, sir, make it fast. This is not India. I remember that famous thing, you know. But anyway, he ordered something and we carried it. And he walked around Oxford Street and this thing. I remember this very clearly. We went to Bond Street Air India office. Now, what happened at the Air India office is something that has got stuck in my mind. He opened the manager's door. The manager was not there. He went and sat in his chair, put his legs up, and dialed Usha and mom in Mumbai. And talk for 1 hour. I can understand this. Are you allowed to do this in the Air India office? Then the Air India guy said, no, this is his home. Every year he comes to London, he does this. He, pretty this thing, he said, don't worry, he's at home in our Air India office. Then he took me back. This, and next day I left on the European tour. And I remember he waved out to me when I boarded the cab at 4 o'clock in the morning. And
see the coincidence.
Yeah. What is it?
Is it that Sunaina? Is it Sunaina?
Yeah, I remember that. Rimu talked about the car. Can I just add one incident?
Yeah,
please.
Can I add that? Okay. Talking about the black ambassador, you know, he had a black ambassador, as Rimu said it very rightly. And he used to wear a white shirt and black. Many people thought, as Rimu rightly said, that he was a government servant. They thought he was a government servant. Mm-hmm. You know, I was studying in this Walsingham school in Napency Road in KG, first standard. And the principal one day announced, if you meet anyone at the, see any student at the bus stop or the Nepenthe Road bus stop next to St. Stephen's Church, please pick them up and bring them to school because they shouldn't be late. I told Dad, Dad said, no, no, I'm not picking up anybody. No, no, no. I said, no, the school principal's order. He said, I'm not picking up anybody. See, every time we are used and turning at the junction, St. Stephen's Church junction, I had to see. If I found anyone from the Walsingham school uniform, I had to duck under the car and go and get down. I mean, I thought it was anything. Why are you ducking? I said, you're not picking up anybody. I get into trouble with the principal of the school. But fine. So that procedure went on and on and on for a number of years. Then at finally, I told Dad, look, I'm going on my own. I'm catching a bus and going to school. Bus number 132, Bhood at that time. And parted company with.
So my next question is kind of different. Like, as you mentioned that, you know, in your space, behind your being space cake, there is a huge contribution of R.K. Lakshman, because he actually ignited that. Ignited your passion for space.
Yes.
So likewise, I want to ask others also, like, what was his contribution in your career?
Oh, yeah, I can start with Rimu.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't think so. Any, like, he is inspired me to drive like a pro. He has inspired me to live life with passion and do the things that I'm like, work in the field that I'm passionate about and things like that, same as my dad. Yeah. But I was too young when like he started having health issues. And by the time I got into a place where I could make life decisions according to what I need to do, he wasn't there with us. So that way he has not influenced me, but I would say that I have a lot of his characteristics and his determination to do things. I'm not saying that I'm as good as him, but when he was determined to fix, say, a radio that had broken in the house, he would do it until it is fixed. He won't leave it halfway. Even if he bought a new radio and kept it, even if 100 people gifted us a new radio, he would still finish repairing the radio that he started repairing. It was something that he carried throughout his life, and I just hope that I do half of that. Sorry, I have a dog here. She's just running around.
Yeah, that's why I see over here.
Yeah, so in career-wise, he didn't have much influence, but it was mainly because he was not there to guide me during those times. But yeah, whatever he guided me when I was really young, I still remember those things.
Would you like to talk about Common Woman?
That's a very important question. Very, very important.
Common Woman was my brainchild when I was 9 years old, because everybody used to talk about the common man, and it used to be man, man, man all the time. And I was like, ooh, I'm going to be a woman someday, and there's nobody to like talk about my issues and my feelings. It was something that I just came up with. But my mom has worked really hard to take it forward from there. So she knows more about it right now than I do.
Would you like to share it?
Yeah, would you like to share?
Creating the Common Woman concept was, of course, very interesting and very close to our heart, because she now is the spokesperson for carrying this Lakshman legacy forward. And we do have a lot of ideas that we are planning to execute in this birth anniversary that we are celebrating. So watch out, guys. It's very soon you'll come to know the different plans that we have as far as Common Woman is concerned, and how she is going to be the spokesperson to carry Lakshman's works and his legacy forward.
Neeti, would you like to add something? You have been like looking in the last 2 years. So
yeah, if according to how it's influenced my career, is the like his thought process, like the creative process shouldn't be rushed. So I use that in my workplace also. Like, so don't rush me until I finish my work. Mm-hmm. So that's there, but like his ideologies have actually inspired me. I've seen so many cartoons like throughout the years. I've seen piles of it. I've seen files of it. So it's really inspiring that what his cartoon is so relatable to this day and age, and is so relevant to all happening events, like all events which are happening right now in this day and age. And so just, and it's actually inspiring too as a young adult, and actually like his way, his persona, his personality actually helps in a workplace also, and in your personal life also. So this is how I want to be, and this is what personality I actually want to take, like a bits and pieces from him. So that's what is more inspiring for me.
Can you give a few examples?
Did you hear? Yeah.
Can you give two examples?
Few examples, like one or two examples.
I don't think she heard you.
Hello.
Can you give examples, Niti?
Can you hear us, Niti? Niti?
I think Niti is disconnected.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So now I want to ask you all, what how will you describe your relation with him? Like, how was he as a grandfather? How was he as a father? How was he as a you know? I would really like to know that.
I'll stop.
Please.
Your question is, what was the father and son relationship?
Yeah, yeah.
Let me be very frank, it was not very informal as I am with my daughter right now. It was not at all. It was a little restricted, and he had a little, he was very fun, I'm not denying it. But I can't say I could be very free or easygoing with him. It was a little, I mean, I don't know how to put it, but I mean, there were a little restricted right below this thing. So that's it. I mean, today, I mean, I'll be very frank with you. There are a lot of gangsters, liberal times they have after Saturday Night Fever. We enjoy Rams, Nindi, and this thing. I didn't have the same freedom at all that time.
On the other hand, if I have to say, I would say the complete opposite, because as a grandfather, he was the most loving, and you could tell him anything and everything, and he will advise you as to how to go ahead. And if you don't want the advice, he will just listen to what you have to say and just have a conversation like that. And it was complete opposite according to what my dad is saying. Another thing is that a lot of people used to be afraid to open his door while he was working, like his room door, because he used to work in our house sometimes. I used to come back from school and like I used to not know the concept of knocking. I used to just enter his room and like start asking him questions, and he would stop his work to give me his full attention. And he would, like, every day after school, he used to tell me a different story about his life and things like that. So I've had a completely different experience than what my dad is saying.
And what about you, Shanti?
Oh, with me, of course, it's very, very emotional. As I think I have stated this time and again, everywhere that I spoke of him, when I got married and came, you know, that's the kind of emotion he actually showed towards people, which actually came so pure, so direct from his heart, with no kind of, frills attached to it. So it's like when he used to introduce me, you know, when we got married, there were parties galore where the entire city of Mumbai was introduced to me. And then he would say, he would the pride that he had about his family was something, any kind of statement would be an understatement. So he would say, okay, look, this is my daughter happened to have married my son. He could not bring himself to call me as a daughter-in-law ever. You know, that's the way he used to introduce me. Not only dad, mom as well. Both mom and dad, that's the way they welcomed me into the family. And that's the way they treated me right through. And that's the way he would introduce me very proudly. And he also used to add another adjective, my world's famous daughter. Let me introduce my world's famous daughter who has happened to have married my son. So that's the closest thing that I can actually relate to, which explains everything about him. Very, very, he was a very, very emotional person. And I remember once, like when we had a guest from Australia, she had come over for dinner, and he, me, and Tikri saw her down. It was pretty late in the evening, around 11 o'clock. And as we were going down, the dog downstairs heard some noise, and somebody opened the door, and it kind of pounced at me. And he never, you know, thought twice. The moment we saw this guest out, he immediately took me to Breach Candy Hospital. And saw that in the as an outpatient, whether I got my tetanus done. And, that's a kind of concern, and that's a kind of spontaneity he had as far as not only the family, but with everybody, one and all. In fact, here I can also bring in one more incident of a cook whom we had who served us for more than 15 years. So it so happened in the middle of his tenure, he was discovered, found that he had tuberculosis. And then generally, you know, tuberculosis means one would want to keep the patient away, completely away from you. But he saw to it that he drove him to the hospital, then admitted him in the hospital. And then every evening after work, he would come home, pick up, a bottle of juice, would go there to see that, you know, and feed him personally, to see that he had this juice, see that he ate his food, see that he took his medicine, never bothered about himself. You know, that's the kind of feeling he had about people, one and all. So I think I can just go on talking. So, yeah.
So how he used to manage his work and family balance?
That was perfect time management he had. When he was in the office, it was his work. When he came home, he allocated time for the family the first 1 hour before he started his freelance work. And he would time his freelance work in such a way, he would not work beyond 9 o'clock, come what may. And after 9, it was family time. After 9, he sat with his drinks every evening for about half an hour. That's when he would sit with the family. And he was very particular that the family was back home by then. And then discuss with us about his day schedule, our day schedule. So it was like a sharing time that we had dinner together. We, you know, because breakfast and lunch, it was never together. So at least dinner was always together with the family. And post dinner, again, it used to continue. And there were some hilarious anecdotes that he used to share with us. While he was around, he always kept us in stitches. And, you know, there was never, ever a dull moment that we had while he was around. So,
the family dinner and all was interesting. But one day I'll never forget in my life.
Can I?
9 p.m., as usual, he used to sit with his drinks. One day the telephone rang here. That time the black phone just behind the wall here. And I picked it up and he said, I told him it's your brother, he wants to talk to you. It sounded a bit grim. And the news was very unfortunate. His mother had passed away. My God, I'll never forget that night. He cracked up completely, but surprisingly, he kept on having his drinks. I couldn't understand the situation at all. You know, going to the bar here, mixing it, having fine. Mom tried to console him, this, that and all, but he never found. What shocked me was, next morning, it was, I remember, this was a Friday night. Saturday morning, Tim, with his white shirt, black pants, looked normal. He said, come, hurry up. We're getting late for, I was in college or something, Elphinstone College. I have to drop you and go to work. He drove me talking about everything about Marine Drive, this, that, he used to, and I look at the people, walkers, he used to comment about all that, and that influence has come to me, observing road when I walk, you know, the pavement of Mumbai, which is the largest city, and looking at people. And as though that was not enough, that night I still remember that very well. The British High Commission had a cocktail party Saturday night. He dressed up super booted. Mom was absolutely this thing. He attended the party and continued as the life was normal. Practical, realistic, and he never went to Mysore to attend any function. He never believed in rituals, he never believed in tradition. He never, though he was, I mean, he prayed, but he was not religious. I still remember after the threat ceremony, before 4 days before my marriage, Tirupati, October 14th, the 18th was the wedding, and I still remember that very clearly when we boarded the train to back, that time, you know, we came by train to Mumbai, he told me, as soon as you board, take out your thread, I don't want you to follow anything. I don't have it. He told
me. Can I just interject something?
Yeah.
He was always religious. He was not like into
ritualism
things, like even going to the temple and everything. He respected religion to no end, but yes, he didn't believe in like the ceremonies ritual and things like that. He's like, wherever you are, there God is. So yeah, even if you close your eyes and you pray in your house, it's the same thing as though you're going to the other end of the world to visit a temple and things like that. So he always had God in his heart. He just didn't have the materialistic feel that you need to do something to get the appreciation for God, or that God needs to feel appreciated through what things that you do.
And every place of worship across the world he has visited, and you know, looking at it in a very artistic way. You know, so that there was an artistic angle towards looking at it, and he has sketched so many of them, whether it were churches or temples or mosques or any of the place of worship. He believed in the artistic thing of it, and he kept his prayers, he kept his emotions well within him. In fact, every morning before going to office, he would pray to his mother, the photograph of his mother,
very important,
which meant everything to him. His mother was everything to him.
If I may, there is an interesting question from Michael D'Souza. From Michael D'Souza.
Okay.
The question is, any experience of his younger days that he has shared with you in any conversation?
Yeah, I have a lot of stories. Because he used to tell me about his younger days every time I used to come back from school. So I don't remember all of it. Obviously, I was very young to retain all of that. But the one story that I do remember is of his father getting stuck in the bathroom of their house in Mysore. And he being the most athletic or the most young or the brother that was there who was athletic, he had to climb up to the second floor to see whether his father was all right and to unlock the bathroom door from the window on the second floor. So he climbed up the two stories from outside of their house and he took a stick or something and he had to unlock the bathroom door so that people can enter and rescue his father who had fallen down there. I used to think he was Superman at the time because for me, it was never normal to climb up some like two stories just to see into a window. And hearing things like that, it just makes you think that
he walked on that thin ledge. He walked on the thin ledge which had no support because it was all along the wall. So he walked on the thin ledge, never thought about himself, but at that point of time, it was for him to save his father. Yeah, go ahead, Dreams.
No, that's all. I don't remember. Like, I remember more than that, but this is the one thing that I remember.
I love the fact that he never liked to go to school. That's my favorite.
That's a good one.
Yeah. He loved learning and he loved reading, but actually going to school again was something that he was never interested in. He would rather sit at home and develop his own artwork and read his own books and things like that, rather than go to an educator who will like force knowledge onto him or enforce not even knowledge, force learning onto him.
Yeah.
So he used to tell me that his elder brother had to drag him by the ears and take him to school. And because before that, when they used to allow him to go, he never actually went to the school. He used to say that he's going and then gallivant the entire day and then come back at night. And the parents used to believe that he has actually gone to the school, whereas he used to just be with his friends and things like that. Once the parents found out about that, the elder brother had to literally drag him to the school by the ears, you know, if he refused to go.
Sounds like my kind of person.
Yeah, I think all of us are like that now.
And then finally, when he went to school, he kind of reconciled, saying, "School is not bad at all because I get to doodle my peer group, my teachers." And I believe in all his textbooks and exercise books, all that you could see is sketches galore. So that's the way he started enjoying.
I think he looked at school and work the same way. Because there's a cartoon from Lakshman sir. There's a quote from Lakshman sir that says, I don't want to go to work, something like that. I don't want to go to work, but the moment I go to work and come back and finish it, I start loving work or something like that.
Yes. So he used to literally whine in the mornings, saying, "Why do I have to go to work? I don't want to go to work. Why can't I be like others, like a banker or an engineer or a lawyer, where I don't have to break my head over, creating something every day and things like that." Literally like a child, he used to whine. And then by evening, he would say, "Oh, it was not bad at all."
So when it comes to fathers and grandfathers and everything, there's one cliche thing that every South Indian father or grandfather would say. My father even says it today. The thing is, in Tamil, they would say, "Nangala andha kaalathula eppadi irundhom theriyuma," which means, "Do you know how we used to be back in those days? We were not like you folks." Do you remember anything like that? Has he, sometimes he would have done something naughty and then he would be like, "Do you know how we used to be in that day?" or something. Do you remember something like that? Getting caught by Lakshman sir?
Remove.
No, I mean, as a grandfather, he used to be very involved, but only in the things that I used to tell him, and I was a very good kid. I never did anything.
That's true. You were not a brat. Yeah.
Yeah, I've grown into my brattiness now.
Yeah, I think that Srinivas sir can answer that.
Yes, he has. Any thing where you got where dad twisted your ears?
Twisted my ears.
Your younger days.
I remember the story about my father burning newspapers near our terrace with his friends. So basically, he wanted to make something like a bonfire or something, and that too inside our building, right, like a flight of stairs from our house. And when my grandfather came to know about that, he got really angry with my father. Another time is, I think, when my dad had alcohol and he came home. And my grandfather and my grandmother caught him having alcohol, and they said that if you have alcohol again, you don't need to enter the house or something.
Caught red hand.
Until
the last day of my granddad's day, my granddad did not know that my dad actually has alcohol on a fairly regular basis. He used to hide from him and have alcohol even when I was around 10-12 years old. So like just a few years even before my grandfather got sick.
Yeah, true, true. Very true.
Very true.
So I have a question. You guys must have interacted and come across a lot of people because of him. So do you have any memories related with that?
Yeah, I think you should say, because memories about meeting people through him.
Yeah.
Through him, I mean, yeah, there were quite a few. I mean, I had great admiration for this writer called Tom Morris, and I suppose I lost it afterwards. Yeah. At that time, I was interested in literature and all that. But through him, I came to know him. Then he came home, read poems. There are quite a few. I mean, today, those people are not there. That I. But a lot of people, a lot of anecdotes, a lot of interesting things, like entire the nuclear fraternity were connected with the Pokhran test. People whom I really admire, like Raja Ramanna, Dr. Chidambaram, Dr. P.K. Iyengar, the people behind India's nuclear weapon program whom I really worship and admire. Thanks to my dad only, I came to know all, interacted with them and all. And today, Dr. Chidambaram is there and we are in touch. A lot of it. Thanks to him.
Before going to Romanica, I have one more question for you. You used to work with him in the same office.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Extremely good question. I was waiting for that. You thought of it.
Yeah.
You see, I used to... How long?
You speak.
Okay. This is a strange case when my father and son were working in the same floor, the same office, getting off the same car and going up the Times of India building in opposite BT. And I can tell you, it is not a very comfortable experience, because the guy, I used to work in the editorial hall, and he had a cabin right in the corner. One thing I still remember is that for some strange reason, mom said you have to have lunch with him every day at 1 o'clock. See, as a reporter, we didn't have timings at all. You know, we had to go out on assignment, this, that, and all. And anyway, I agreed on it. Bit reluctantly, of course. I'm being very honest today in this interview. I don't want to appear very emotional or that sort of thing. I'm being very honest. I wanted to sit with my own colleagues, chit chat, gossip, stab people on the back, which we normally do. And listen, anyway, I went. Sometimes at 12:59, I used to go. He used to say, 1 minute, you have to wait outside. And I used to, then he, sometimes in the night, he used to sit here in the hall while having his drinks, and he said, what have you written today? What is your story? Some days I didn't have, some days I had, and he used to read it and said, no, it's badly written, this you should have got out. I mean, that helped me. Huh? I'm telling you, that really helped me. I mean, in future, when I started working on stories and all, I used to keep in mind what he wanted, what he did. I'm glad he did the post-mortem and analysis. That was good, pretty good. But when he used to sit me talking to a lot of people, sometimes, why are you chit-chatting so much in the editorial hall? You're supposed to be concentrating on your computer and this thing. Don't talk. That's a separate book for myself. I was working with dad in the Times of India group. And it is not very easy. I'm sorry to say, I'm being very frank, very open. But Yeah, I mean, nobody has undergone that experience as I did.
Okay, so meeting about meeting people through him has been a great experience, definitely, because we used to have cocktail and dinner parties at home, probably, you know, every other week, every other Saturday night. And there used to be the who's and who's of Mumbai would come, the consulate codes would come. So it used to be very, very interesting because thanks to him, we got an opportunity to meet all of them, to listen to their conversations and to learn a lot about so many, subjects, related, because there were people that came from the police force, there were doctors, there were different corporates, there were, of course, consulate codes. So you can imagine the amount of, knowledge that we got through this and the exposure that we got. And besides that, even going out to parties with him and meeting people galore was very, very, very interesting, exciting, and of course, all that is memory now for us, definitely.
Can I add one thing here?
Yeah.
This incident happened very recently. Usha and I were invited to one cocktail and dinner at Boili. This was about 2 years back.
Last
year. Tushar Jani's party, I remember
this
that.
Year.
That
this
was
year.
2 years back.
This year.
This year is not, January. Not this year, it was last year.
January.
No, what I'm going to say to last year. Okay. And a lot of people, they introduced Usha. I went because of Usha's contact to me. This year. And they introduced me as Srinivas Tafun. One gentleman said hello and walked off. Then the person who introduced called that fellow, do you know who he is? Said, the Lakshman's son. Then he said, oh, completely. Then I said, you are now saying all this because somebody said, otherwise, why did you walk up? And Pusha said, you should have said all that. That's not very nice of you to have said it. It's a fact.
But honestly, my grandfather was like that only. He used to tell me also that anybody you meet, you have to treat them with respect, no matter who they know or what you're trying to get out of them. You have to be respectful and you have to be kind to each and every person. Like, there is no other option. You cannot act rude or mean to anybody. It doesn't reflect well on you, and you will be a very miserable person if you start Absolutely. Having that negativity towards a person before you've even spoken to them.
Right. Absolutely.
I think partly because he has so many contacts is partly because he is very straightforward, respectful, and he has a good rapport with, like, you know, a lot of his contacts. That's why he has that many contacts. It's partly because of how he treats other people.
True. Very true. So, having dealt with them, having sketched about them and things like that, so he knows what it is, the diverse kind of people that he has met. And basically himself was like that. So there is no two things to it, It is something very natural about him. And he viewed everyone in the same line. It could be a Rockefeller or it could be somebody, who's probably not a Rockefeller. But to him, they were all same. And he practiced it not out of anything. It came very, very natural to him. And I think those are the learnings which we as family have taken it and, of course, try to practice it as much as we could and keep remembering that, to be able to treat everyone as same. And as Rimu Ramanika said, that, you always have to be nice and good to people. That's the kind of goodwill he has left behind. Today, one and all, whoever, learns about him, that and when I talk to whoever the person saying I'm so-and-so, the kind of reaction that I get from them, it's amazing and it's overwhelming to know the goodwill that he has left behind. And I think that is one take that we all have to take and leave it behind for generations to come.
That was my next question. What is your one learning?
Yeah, actually, to remember the days when I was in Oxford, me and Ramanika, those of you new here and everything, me and Ramanika were flatmates in Oxford. So basically, I was the first person that she would see when she's going to walk out, because my room was at the end and her room was at the other end. So basically, we used to share the same kitchen, and I used to call her if I didn't have something to eat. I used to call her, like, Ramanika, I have nothing to eat. And she'll be like, just take whatever you want. Let's see. It might be funny and everything, but the thing is, she always shared whatever she had.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever she had, there was nothing. She would never complain. She would never say anything. I think she had learned it from her grandfather. After all the things that you guys have spoken, now I understand where it's come from.
Yeah, and not only grandfather, even her grandmother. Her grandmother was an epitome and a standing example as far as people are concerned. There cannot be any person who can walk out of the house without being fed by her. And she did that till the end of her life, you know. And the generosity that she had was something amazing. I mean, and what people mattered to her. And she was a total people's person. There have been so many cases where there were people who wanted to meet dad, and for whatever reason, he did not meet them, probably because he was busy, he had his commitments and things like that. And so they always used to get connected to him through mom. And then she saw to it, she managed the time for him to see that everybody got to meet him. You know, that's the kind of a person she was. And the support that she gave to her husband was something today. And she was like a memory to him. She was like a memory card to him. You know, he was there was a lot of support that she gave. You know, it's a very standard statement. People say that, you know, for every man, there is a woman behind. So this was in a different angle together, in a different way altogether that, you know, she lent to him, because they were they were brought up together right from. Mom was born when dad was 5 years old. So they had like a whole life in front of them, right from their childhood days till they died.
I think she's her own superstar. She had her children's book, her own children's book and all that, right?
Yes.
So she's her own creative content creator. She's her own superstar.
I think we need a separate life to cover that.
Yeah.
Definitely, definitely. Definitely, there is so much to talk about her, and there's so much learning. You know, I was a very shy person when I got married, and then to come suddenly into the limelight in a city of Mumbai, which is so different. Fari, you'll agree with me. You're all from Chennai, and you know what it is, the transformation that took place in me. In fact, my family used to ask, how is that you were able to handle something like this? But I think that I was able to handle this purely because of the family support I got from Tikri, from mom and dad. You know, the way they have given me that comfort of facing the world of something like Bombay. So I think that, and that I learned from mom. She gave that confidence in me. Today I'm able to talk or write or whatever I am doing is purely because of the support I got from her.
So that's going to be one last question from me. Then I'll hand it over to you, Ruchira.
Yeah.
So if all of you can, if you can define Lakshman sir in one word, what would that word be? Let's start with whoever wants to start first.
Srinidhi. Go for this thing.
Srinidhi. Define Lakshman sir in one word.
Passionate.
Okay. Next.
Passionate. Okay. Malika.
I don't know. There's so many words that come to mind.
I know, just
loving, respectful, humble. Like, there are so many words, but like.
So Srinidhi's answer was from a creator's point of view. And your answer was from a grandfather's point of view.
Yeah.
Okay, so I feel like more passionate, straightforward, amazing, brilliant.
So basically all the synonyms for passion,
everything,
and all the synonyms for love, and then my mom and dad can say.
So I would say empathy and sympathy that he had, you know, and today you can see that through the common man that he created, the empathy that he had for people, which again, that reflects in his cartoon because it came from his heart.
Then I'll add that one more thing.
Yeah.
You know, when I wrote my first book, Dreams to Reality, the biography of Abdul Kalam, he did the cover design for me. Kalam standing on a rocket in his hand and all. I wrote the book. The book sold well. But the secret is the book sold because of the cover rather than the content. I'm so
I don't
happy.
think that is true. His content just helped your boosted your biography.
Yes, James, go ahead.
His caricature drawing or whatever, it just boosted your already, what do
Absolutely.
you call it?
Where would I have been without the cover? Absolutely.
You would have had another cover and it would have done as well, but
You did one cover for me.
there is a book that you brought up earlier.
Evergreen, she has mentioned
Okay.
it.
Oh my God.
Did you get it? I got it here.
No.
Yeah. Acha,
Why?
one word. Awesome. Awesome.
Thank you so much, guys. And there's one more person who has commented, Geeta Loganathan, who has commented, Lakshman was quick-witted.
Yes,
Yeah.
true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that should be a special mention here. Back to you, Ruchira.
If you ask me, Fari, I will say he was R.K. Lakshman. There's only one word we can describe, which we can describe him. That is
Yeah.
R.K. Lakshman. We don't have to describe him in any other word
Yeah,
because
all
it is,
adjectives
yeah,
coming
all
up.
adjectives come in that one particular
Interesting.
particular word. So now I will ask you very light and last question. And that is. How was he about his birthday? What, like, he was so excited about your birthdays, but how was he when his birthday is there, and what was his reaction, and how you used to celebrate his birthdays?
Okay, I can say that.
Yeah.
While
Yeah.
in Bombay, I don't think he knew that was his birthday. When he was there. But when they moved to Pune, in his Irish park, those local Punekers made it a point that every year on the ground floor, in the garage area, they must celebrate his birthday. So the who's and who's of Pune used to come, and all those. Then they started celebrating in Pune. Yes.
That was purely because, you know, he didn't want his birthdays to be celebrated as far as his birthday was concerned. He was excited about the family's birthday, but with his birthday, you would say all days are my birthdays. You know, that was his like
Exactly.
standard.
But he used to celebrate each day with us like that only, that each day is a gift. And he would do things for us throughout the year. Like for me, I used to be very interested in arts and crafts. He used to not wait till my birthday to get me like an arts and craft thing. He used to do that all year round whenever I wanted it, or whenever he saw that like the my drawing and sketching books were like coming to an end and things like that. He used to literally make it all about the rest of the family, because he used to get a lot of appreciation outside and inside the family. He never thought of having, oh, it's my birthday, I need to celebrate it. It used to be like every day is a celebration for everybody. Only his gift cards used to be something special that he used to give us, and I don't think any of our drawing capabilities were that well that we could return the favor. But of course, I, as a kid, have made a lot of drawings and cards for his birthday, and he used to hang that up with so much pride. And every time I used to go visit him in Pune, he used to show me all the cards that he had framed and preserved and kept on the wall.
In
So
fact, even the when you know the newspaper and TV channels used to come, he had one particular sketch that Rimu has done right under on his table, and he would call tell them and say, first you take a video of that and then start from there. This is my granddaughter has done it. You know, that's a kind of pride. In fact, I have put that below his photograph in my house, you know, as a memory. And there was something I wanted to add, I forgot.
Yeah. So I was asking, how did you celebrate his birthday? Because I remember seeing one picture where there is one, you know, guard with the there are chocolates, and you have he's wearing chocolates in that picture. So do you have anything to say about it?
I think that's again, as Tikri said, when this was celebrated in Pune, somebody had given him a garland of chocolates because he started that was a time he became very fond of chocolates. And in fact, he was not allowed to eat, but then maybe that's the reason why he was started getting being very fond of chocolates. And then he used to take it quietly and put it in his pocket to see that nobody saw it, you know. Somebody
Especially my
had to
grandmom.
notice that and realize that, you know, they should give him a garland of chocolate on his birthday.
Okay.
I guess that's what it is.
His birthday used to be small celebrations for us, as in the house we used to obviously have dinner together every night, but on his birthday we would probably cut a cake and things like that, and it used to be more family time than a celebration of anything.
Right.
But as people got to know his birthday, they used to make it into a big function for us to all celebrate his birthday. That's what I can say.
And another interesting thing, if Rimu, if you'd like to share, you know, when you were a kid, he used to narrate stories, both mom and dad, both your grandparents, and he used to make you sit on a chart paper and actually sketch. In fact, I shared that with a fairy called Kutila's World. You know, Ramanika used to be called, a pet name was Kutila, and he used to actually sketch and narrate stories. Do you have any memories of that?
I have memories of him sketching and showing me his sketches and everything, but I don't think I remember him narrating a story according to the sketch.
Yeah.
I used to remember that he used to sketch in front of me, and at one point of time when I was 5 years old or something, when I didn't really know who my grandfather was to the rest of the world, I used to say that you don't know anything about sketching, and I used to take the pen away from him and I used to sketch something, and he used to be floored with that. Like, he was like, definitely you will get a job in the art world, you will be very big and things like that. Once I came to know who he was to the rest of the world, R.K. Lakshman, the cartoonist, I used to feel so hilarious that this scene has ever happened between us. And he was so nice about it. Like, his granddaughter is like literally telling a great cartoonist that he doesn't know anything, and he was still willing to learn from what I was doing as a little child. That's what I remember. I don't remember him telling stories about what he was doing.
You used to be hardly 1 year old, he used to make you sit on the chart paper and sketch and tell you, and even on your crib, he's drawn a big elephant with a little flower, you know, and things like that. So that Kutila's World book is all about Kutila's dog, Kutila's cat, Kutila's pets, Kutila's this, and I don't know if it's there on
this. But growing up, we never had a dog in the house. After he moved out of our house, that's when I brought a dog into our house.
Yeah, yeah. But then he used to relate to everything that was around.
Yeah, but your what part I was getting to was, the dog that I actually adopted and brought into our house looks exactly like the dog that he drew.
Yeah.
And that freaked me out a little bit when I saw the drawing.
True. Absolutely.
So he's probably psychic also.
Probably.
Yes. He had that sixth sense in him. He had that, you know, premonition in him. He had that vision in him that, you know, this is the way probably it will be.
But I think he was a firm believer of live your life to the fullest every day.
Yes. Very well put, Nidhi. Very well put.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Very positive.
So that's why he celebrated every day. So very positive. Yeah.
True, true.
So, Fari, do you have any more questions?
No, Ruchira.
Okay. So, any one of you, anything you want to add?
What I want to definitely add is in line with the celebration that we are doing, you know, which this year is the start of the 100th birth anniversary of Lakshman. And I feel that we are actually reliving this when he was alive. Like, you know, the kind of people that we are interacting with and trying to get on board, the kind of people we've already got on board, like Dr. Chidambaram, Mr. Bharat Abolkar, and Mr. Ravish Kumar, and many, many, many more to come that's, you know, on our list, and with whom I'm in talks already. It's like I feel that how we used to interact with all of these people when he was alive, and we are enliving that now. And that's a very overwhelming feeling that I have. And I'm very glad that I'm able to do it. And that's completely thanks to people like Ruchira, Fari, and his team, who are part of it, and of course my family. So I'm indeed very grateful and thankful.
Thanks for an opportunity you gave
No, it's a like enlightening experience for us too. Like we discussed in the morning.
Yes,
it's an overwhelming experience.
Thank you for giving me.
There's another point that I'd like to add in this.
Yeah,
Fari and my grandfather share the birthday, so
wow.
Everybody in the comments need to wish him as well tomorrow.
Absolutely. And look at the connect. Like, you know, when I used to talk to Fari and then say discuss, you know, how we could go about his Lakshman legacy and all, I did not know. And then I used to tell him, look at Fari, look at your involvement and look at the way, you know, you have even before I complete a sentence, you understood what I have in mind. And then I feel again, there is some kind of a connect. You know, and when he told me my birthday is also on the 24th, I was really overwhelmed. I said, look, there's some kind of a message that is coming from up that, you know, it is Fari who has to take the social media platform forward, because this is something I've been wanting to do. I was not able to crack it until I met Fari. And I think I have to thank Rimu for that, for the discussion that she had with him in Oxford and introduced me to him, and today here we are. It's completely Fari, thanks to you and the brilliant team that you have.
It's wonderful work you are doing. This
thank you so much.
Fari,
happy returns of the day in advance.
So
I have just one thing to add. You know, on the chat we have Dad's niece Priya.
Yeah.
There's something she asked, a question she asked. I don't know whether it has been captured. She has left. Probably she'll come tomorrow and we can add that.
Yeah. So we can reply to the comments after this is over also.
Yeah, okay. Yes. Fine.
tomorrow is IK Lakshman's birthday and we are starting his 100th year. And we are going to celebrate it for next 1 year, and on occasion of that, again tomorrow at 6:30 PM we are meeting, and why are we meeting? So you guys know that we launched one competition, and it was a sketch, then a blog and video competition where people came up with their idea of their ideal nation, and we really got good number of participants. And really great entries, and tomorrow we are announcing all our winners in tomorrow's live, and we also have one interesting surprise for you all, which is surprise, so I won't talk about it. So tomorrow in our session we will be having all three judges. One is Mr. Shreyas Navve. He was judging cartoon category. Then Geeta ma'am, she was judging blog category, and Bharat Dabholkar sir, he was judging video and audio category. So they will be coming live with us, and they will be announcing all these winners. And also we will be having Mr. Shiva Kabra, who is going to sponsoring all the gifts to our winners, and we won't say what it is. It is surprise again. So we are really looking forward to meet you all tomorrow. And before going, so YOLO is our partner in this thing. Fari, would you like to talk about YOLO?
Yes.
Okay. YOLO is YOLO stands for Youth Online Learning Organizations. So we're doing a campaign with them regarding online safety. So how to stay safe online in regards with you know, online bullying. There's a lot of bullying going on social media, and then there's this credit card theft, identity theft, and all this going on. So they are creating awareness about this and how to tackle those situations. So we are working with them. We are creating comics for them, and they have been doing an amazing job in creating that awareness panel here.
And we are back to you. Yeah, and we are also thankful to YOLO, because even for the contest, they have come forward and helped us, and we've had some overwhelming response. And as Ruchira said, there's something very a surprising thing. Probably we will launch it tomorrow.
Yeah.
And that is, of course, we are thankful to YOLO for helping us out on this.
Yeah. And last but not least, if you guys are not following us on our Instagram, Facebook and YouTube, then please follow us. We are active on all these three platforms. Farik will share our links in the comment section so that you can go click and follow us. And please write your feedbacks to us, write your questions, or you know, if you have any ideas, if you have anything in your mind which you would like to share with us, please write to us. It really means a lot to us. And share it with your friends. Share all this conversation with your friends. If you are getting any eureka moment during this conversation, then share that eureka moment with us, because we are really eager to know that. We are doing all these things for that only. And connect with us, join hands in this initiative. We are really grateful to all of those who are joining us in these sessions. And from next month onwards, again, we are meeting. And tomorrow, we are meeting again to celebrate birthday. So be ready with your cake and let's
have a party tomorrow. For the celebration.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, viewers, to be part of this session. Thank you.
It was fun interacting with you all. And
thanks for all your comments. And
there is a lot of fun today. Dem, Hindi, Suchira, I don't know how I feel. Farid.